Celebrating 30 years of Star Trek, this is BBC2, your space station.
Sometime, somewhere in the universe, there's a memorial to Chief Engineer Montgomery Scott with the phrase,
"I cannot change the laws of physics, Captain!"
etched on it. With the help of proper grown-up scientists, Star Trek Night now investigates whether the show's spaced-out scientific vision tallies with today's scientific fact.
You know, sometimes I feel like a small particle in a very large nucleus.
Now that I am a spaceman.
We're doing a show that helps shape the way people view the future, even down to their sense of style and design. It's all of our aspirations about what the world will be like if science does a good job.
I want you to make a good run. I want you to go to the moon.
And it's had a real significant influence on the way people view science and technology, and even the way some scientists view their own work. But my job is to make sure that this show appears scientifically possible. And in here is what we have to make fly.
Hi, I'm Andre Bormanis. I'm the science consultant for the Star Trek series.
Andre who?
Bormanis.
Bormanis, can you spell that for me?
Andre Bormanis, subatomic particle in the vast chain of interactions that produce Star Trek, is science advisor to the show. Trained as an astrophysicist, he used to work for NASA. But now he's employed by Paramount Studios, where Star Trek has been filmed for the past 30 years. It's Andre's job to make sure the accuracy of the photon torpedo, the healing powers of Dr. McCoy, the range of the transporter, and the stability of the warp drive abide by the laws of physics. And every day he struggles to bring scientific credibility to the work
Andre.
In progress. His role is to tech the writer's scripts.
Some tech help with this part right here.
Okay, we're talking about electrical resistance in a person's skin.
Maybe some actual, like...
Sometimes the writers aren't aware of how much they're really asking me to stretch science. And that's a bit of a challenge.
Yeah, and it needs to be some actual, like, tech, biochemical, like, real change that happens in this ritual that lets them deal with this energy field.
We had an episode that involved the crew devolving to earlier forms of life, and that was particularly hard to rationalize in scientific terms.
Oh, okay. Great, I'll take care of it.
Sometimes I just invent new terms, like...
Dualnetic field.
And that seemed to be a sort of a simple answer to the problem that needed to be addressed in that episode.
All right, let's go.
Yes.
Action! Shut up!
Andre is a busy man. Every Star Trek episode throws up a new script and a new science problem.
Are you going to help me or not?
Andre, can you talk to you about this for a second? Okay, so we're in this dilapidated prison, and there's this force field keeping these guys from getting out,
yeah.
Kim and Paris. Mm-hmm. And I've got to come up with some believable way that they can gather up some materials and kind of short out this force field. So you remember that time that
Here's an example of a place where we have a certain amount of conflict between the science of the episode and the action that we're trying to sell in the story. Harry could probably fashion some sort of a circuit that would short out a force field. You know, he could take some wires and make some coils.
So should we call it a circuit? He's creating a ground?
Star Trek is trying to portray a plausible vision of the future, so it has to be based as much as possible in real science. But sometimes the action demands of the story maybe make it hard for me to come up with something that's as scientifically accurate as I might like it to be.
I can't change the laws of physics. I've got to have 30 minutes.
But in Cleveland, Ohio, Andre's efforts are being judged by a fan who knows better than anyone whether Star Trek has obeyed, avoided, or completely ignored the laws of physics. Professor Lawrence Krauss has written a book on the physics of Star Trek.
I see where you're going. We ship down, then kick hard into warp 9. Yeah, come back fighting. Woo-wee!
Can we do it, Geordi?
Ask me after it's done, sir.
That's great. This episode is called The Last Outpost. You see, I had to watch almost every episode of the series, and in fact, I use it occasionally in my lectures. In each episode, the Enterprise has to explore a new part of the galaxy, and the galaxy itself is over 100,000 light years across.
Captain's log, stardate 3192.1. The Enterprise is en route to star cluster NGC 321.
So even at the speed of light, you can't get very far in a single episode. Now, this creates all sorts of marvelous physics challenges, in fact, from getting to the speed of light in a few seconds to even exceeding it.
G sub I J of T as T approaches infinity.
Einstein's famous equation, E equals mc squared, produced tremendous obstacles to actually trying to travel at the speed of light. For example, first of all, time slows down as you get near the speed of light, and that means it might take 25,000 years in your frame for the Enterprise to make it to the center of the galaxy. But for the people aboard the Enterprise, it might only take 5 years. But also, as you get closer to the speed of light, the mass begins to increase, in fact, become infinitely large if you hit the speed of light. Well, as impossible as that may sound, the writers of Star Trek got it right when they said,
warp speed, Mr. Sulu.
Because in order to do this, you'd actually have to warp space-time itself.
In order to travel faster than the speed of light, the Enterprise itself can't move at any great speed at all.
Warp 2.
But the warp engines could create a wave in space-time.
Here she goes.
So instead of the ship moving, the space around it moves, allowing the Enterprise to surf through the galaxy without incurring any of the penalties of high-speed travel.
9.7! 9.8!
So the Enterprise can get to places faster than light. And if it can warp space, it can also warp time.
Star Trek has to suppose that one can go faster than light to keep a human interest in their stories. But if you can go faster than light, you can also go back in time.
Now.
Something Star Trek producers have known for years. More recently, though, Stephen Hawking, Cambridge professor and Star Trek extra, has worked out how time travel, too, may be within the laws of physics.
We are used to thinking of time as a single railway line on which one can go only in one direction. But what if the railway line had loops and branches so that one could come back to the same station? It seems that Einstein's general theory of relativity may allow this kind of behavior.
Explain.
I can't.
Time and space are combined together in spacetime. This means that time as well as space can be warped or distorted. That is how time travel may be possible. One might be able to go off in a rocket ship, go through a wormhole, and come back before you set out.
That is a great story.
Quite amusing, Dr. Hawking. You see, Sir Isaac, the joke depends on an understanding of the relativistic curvature of space-time. If two non-inertial reference frames are in relative motion...
Do not patronize me, sir. I invented physics.
But if physics has moved on since Newton, and time travel is possible, the implications are enormous. At Oxford University, Professor Roger Penrose has been musing on the dangers of journeying into the past.
Here's a picture of my grandfather. Well, if you could travel backwards in time, you could kill your grandfather, and then you'd never have been born, and... But if you were born, that's an inconsistency.
Please, Spock, do me a favor. And don't say it's fascinating.
No. Well, more to the point, we'd be killing my father, but he's such a cute little fellow, I'm sure I wouldn't want to do that. But of course, I could do something which he might remember. And he obviously didn't, so that can't have happened.
Interesting.
More relevant, I suppose, is when people talk about going back and meeting yourself. And you obviously remember yourself. And so if you didn't meet yourself earlier in time, then That's illogical.
Your logic can be most annoying.
But elsewhere in space-time, another Oxford physicist, David Deutsch, is convinced time travel does make sense.
Quantum mechanics tells us that the universe we see around us is not the whole of physical reality. There are many such universes all running along in parallel. What happens when there's time travel is that when you go back into the past and try to change it, for instance, to prevent yourself from being born, you really go into the past of another universe, and you prevent the version of yourself that would have been born there from being born.
Never mind, Mr. Spark. Doesn't make much sense to me either.
So the problem of time travel that remains is a technological one. How can we construct a pathway into the past?
Sensors indicate an energy fluctuation directly in our path. Source unknown.
Well, sometimes it's suggested that you could make use of what are called wormholes to travel backwards in time.
Very likely. Small and extremely unstable wormholes have been mapped near 39 T Tauri systems in the last 100 years alone, sir.
We could take a piece of space-time, a little tunnel, any idea, and you glue it back to some much earlier point in time, so that you have this little tube which reaches back into something earlier.
But for Professor Krauss, journeys through wormholes have drawbacks.
At the mouth of the wormhole, you in fact would need a very special kind of matter to create that curvature and keep the mouth of the wormhole open, because normal matter will tend to make the mouth collapse. The other problem is, to curve space at that amount, you need incredible amounts of energy. The sun, for example, bends light by merely 1/1000th of a degree, so you can imagine how much energy you'd need to really bend space and create a wormhole.
What the hell is happening out there?
I don't know. They're just gone.
All right, so these are some of the engineering consoles here on the bridge of the Bird of Prey. We're trying to convey some fairly difficult scientific concepts, and that's really very central to the whole idea of Star Trek. We're typically dealing with technical problems that require technical or scientific solutions.
We've got to take a look at how we're going to get the plasma from the warp reactor out to the wing.
I see.
Through the conduit that we talked about.
Right. Okay.
Rick Sternbach is responsible for much of the technical design in Star Trek. He and Andre work together on the specifications of new ships.
Right, they'd have to monitor each of the pods individually and keep them isolated so that we would not have any sort of antimatter containment breach.
Rick and I are basically trying to solve the problem of how we would describe the technology that allows us to take the energy generated by a reaction of matter and antimatter and distribute that to different parts of a starship. And we want to make sure that those solutions are scientifically credible, that they're built on plausible theories or extrapolations of theories in known science. So the matter-antimatter reaction chamber is here. So good example of this is the engineering of the ships. What drives these ships? Well, the most powerful source of energy we know of today is antimatter.
One day soon, man is going to be able to harness incredible energies, maybe even the atom. Energies that could ultimately hurl us to other worlds in some sort of spaceship. And those are the days worth living for.
30 years ago, antimatter was the stuff of unbelievable science fiction. Today, it's the stuff of impenetrable particle physics.
Gentlemen, ready?
22nd April, 1996. We are continuing our antimatter experiments.
They're injected from the ring now.
These experiments could help the Enterprise fly. And last year, at the CERN Particle Accelerator in Switzerland, Dr. Walter Olet created antihydrogen, the world's first complete atoms of antimatter.
They're in the machine now.
Okay, so here is where it all happened, where we found the first antihydrogen atoms. This is the Lear accelerator ring, where antiprotons always circulate in this ring, round and round like a merry-go-round. And what we did now as a trick, we put in the way of the antiprotons, xenon target.
Okay, the antiprotons left the accumulator.
Antiprotons, which are tiny fragments of antimatter atoms, smash into a cloud of xenon gas and create anti-electrons. Occasionally, an anti-electron bonds with an antiproton and a complete atom of antihydrogen is formed.
Crude methods, but effective.
Millions of particles are created, and we saw some of those in our detector system. So we had to analyze them. And that's why out of this garbage of data, we really had to ask, where could the antihydrogen be?
It's a mystery, and I don't like mysteries.
And finally, after a long, long period, we found these 11 events. So here you are the witness of the first 11 antihydrogens ever seen in the world.
Helm, warp one, engage!
Those 11 atoms have such extraordinary properties that by the 24th century they could be a staple fuel.
Now the thing about antimatter is that it has the opposite properties of normal matter. So say a proton is positively charged, well, an antiproton is negatively charged. Now, when antimatter comes into contact with matter, the two can annihilate completely, producing 100% energy, which is why matter-antimatter annihilations are so efficient at powering the warp drive.
Captain's log, stardate 45433.
No. We don't have any plans to use antimatter here at NASA.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely.
At Mission Control in Houston, NASA aren't relying on those 11 atoms of antihydrogen. They're taking a different route into space, charted by flight director Wayne Hale.
Here in Mission Control, our job is to get the astronauts safely into space and bring them safely back home, to make sure that we can do the most with the shuttle that we can in low Earth orbit. It's not like Star Trek. We don't fly off at warp speed to planets far distant in the galaxy. We don't bend the laws of physics. We don't play relativistic games. We're basically in low Earth orbit for the duration.
Well, I think our role as astronauts today is really on a very early step toward what you see in Star Trek episodes. I love being in space. So far, I've never gotten over the excitement of being able to see the planet beneath us and the stars all around.
Well, today we only go 200 or 300 miles above the Earth's surface, low Earth orbit. Someday soon we'd like to go to the near-Earth planets, Mars, Venus, maybe. To go to a planet around another star, as they do in Star Trek, you have to accelerate to very high velocities, and you have to accelerate in a very short amount of time. And actually that acceleration, the G-forces on the biological system, the people, are what are going to limit us.
During a shuttle launch, we go from basically sitting on the launch pad to a speed of 17,500 miles per hour in about 8.5 minutes. And the G-forces vary during that time. During the last minute or so, you are under about 3 Gs, and it feels basically like someone's standing on your chest.
This is Apollo Control at 11 hours 29.
It may seem trivial compared to the problem of flying at all, but G-forces are a physical fact that could limit manned space travel.
One giant leap for mankind.
So the problem with G-forces is that every time Picard says,
engage,
he's committing suicide. In fact, the crew would be turned into chunky salsa. You see, when you take off from a stoplight, you go from 0 to 60 miles per hour in a few seconds. You get pushed back in your seat. But with the impulse drive, you're going from 0 to, say, half the speed of light in a few seconds, and half the speed of light is about 100,000 miles per second. So you'd never survive.
But the designers of the Enterprise think they've found a scientifically plausible way to counteract G-forces.
So this is the Star Trek The Next Generation technical manual. And in order to deal with the problem of the extreme accelerations of the ship and all of those thousands of G-forces that we encounter, we have an inertial damping system. What it does is it generates a force field that counteracts the force of acceleration that the ship experiences.
See, we push and they push back with equal force, sir.
So this is one of the solutions to the problem of living in space that we've come up with, and this is one of the things that makes life possible and pleasant aboard a starship.
Honey, I'm home.
And just as the crew on the Enterprise can make themselves at home, so can the crew on the International Space Station. They've never had it so good.
This is the habitation module for the International Space Station, and this module will provide living and sleeping and eating quarters for 4 crew members.
And these are their home comforts.
We have a sleeping bag here and some personal area that they can use to read a book or use a computer, and some storage area too. Over here we have the bathroom and hygiene area, and next to it a shower area. A shower will be something that'll be quite a luxury, but it'll be really nice for people staying in space for weeks or months.
Oh, that's quite understandable.
And then next to it we'll have an area in which we can actually gather around as a crew and eat together.
Are you hungry?
Uh-huh.
What would you like?
This is an example of a typical shuttle meal for an astronaut. It's comprised of a thermostabilized entree, which would be it's ready to eat. It's just heat and eat.
Well, I like a lot of the foods that we have on the space shuttle today.
This is a thermostabilized pouch. The addition of the water is made through a septum adapter assembly.
What is that?
And we're looking to add a lot of international food menu items.
Hippias claw. This is heart of targ.
Similar to your canned stews and soups that you have at home.
This, of course, is gog.
You'd heat this in the oven on the shuttle, and then it would be ready to eat.
That doesn't sound very appealing. What else is there?
We have a variety of chicken dishes. We have spaghetti, macaroni, even a kind of a steak that we heat up.
Scallop potatoes, mutton shanks, oxtails and cabbage.
But the way these dishes are created is entirely different in the 24th century.
Really, it's quite simple. You just tell the computer what you want, and it prepares it for you.
Oh. No, I don't see food replication as an option. We hope to have refrigerators and freezers to make our food taste better.
But food replicators, with the ability to turn energy into matter, can prepare any dish in the galaxy. And they're all easy to eat, unlike food on the shuttle.
We have to design the food so that we can eat it without it floating around the cabin, and the same way with drinking and with fluids.
Water.
Specified temperature.
I don't care. Just give me water.
And in fact, the fluids in our body act a little bit differently too in zero gravity, and they shift to different portions of the body. And there are health problems that can occur. Round and
around and around and around. So bring me back down.
How you doing?
Good. Got a couple of questions for you.
Andre Bormanis doesn't have to worry about the medical effects of weightlessness, but he does wrestle with other health problems. Sometimes he needs advice.
There are various experts I consult with when I need to. Mm-hmm. One of the key people I talk to is John Glasgow. He's a pathologist here in town. Well, we're doing a scene on Deep Space Nine where we need to transport a fetus from one woman's womb into another woman's womb. We want to make sure that, in medicine especially, the language and the details are as right as we can get them. Okay, so the entire fetal placental complex has to be transported, not just the fetus itself. People really care about medicine, they care about their health, and there's a lot of expectations out there that medical science will deliver us miracle cures.
As it has in the hyperspray, an idea that always seemed fantastic in Star Trek is now being used on people with a fear of needles.
Hey, ready? Relax your arm. That didn't hurt at all.
But the Star Trek medicine most closely matched by 20th century developments is the use of imaging.
May 21st, 1996. Brigham and Women's Hospital, Boston, Massachusetts. We are starting the preoperative planning for surgery tomorrow. The patient is presented with a difficult aneurysm. However, we are hoping the modeling of her brain will allow us to operate successfully.
Great, that's perfect.
Right now we are making the skin incision and we're beginning the craniotomy.
Dr. Philip Stieg is about to perform a delicate operation to stop potentially fatal bleeding into this patient's brain.
My God, man! Drilling holes in his head's not the answer. The artery must be repaired.
This is exactly what Dr. Stieg is planning to do.
Mike, will you bring in the soft tissue, overlay the blood vessels. Okay, hold on.
But in this procedure, Stieg is guided by a quantum leap in medical imaging. It gives him X-ray vision.
On Star Trek, we try to make credible predictions about the future.
science fiction generally tries to create sort of plausible visions of what tomorrow might be like. One of the areas I think we've gotten right is this medical scanning, the idea of being able to see what's going on inside a person's body. Another thing that we've predicted is non-invasive procedures, being able to do something about a person's medical condition without actually having to cut into human flesh.
Needles, sutures, all the pity. He's had to cut and sew people like garments.
Something Dr. Stieg still needs to do. But this enhanced reality imaging will one day permit non-invasive surgery.
Can you bring out the blood vessels now, please?
Yes, here they are.
Okay. Great. So now what I am able to do is define where my hands are in relation to the vessels and determine what the next move should be in terms of dissection. And what I can also see is the anatomy sufficiently well enough to know where the aneurysm is.
A model of the patient's brain has been built up as a composite from different types of medical images. Laser mapping allows it to be precisely aligned to a live-action video during the operation, giving the surgeon pinpoint accuracy.
It may seem that we are using large holes, or craniotomies is the term we use, to get to the abnormal tissue. It is our goal to try to reduce this and perform surgery in areas that were inoperable.
Thank you, doctor.
The big picture in Star Trek is really trying to harness science and technology toward more humane ends. My job is to focus more on the details, the specific language and concepts within the story. And to keep myself abreast of what's happening out in the real world, I often go out and visit real research laboratories.
V-O-Y-A-G-E-R. Voyager. Voyager 6.
NASA. National Aeronautics and Space Administration. Jim. This was launched more than 300 years ago.
But things at NASA have moved on since Voyager took off.
Cassini is being prepared for launch on October the 6th, 1997, to the planet Saturn.
This is the command and data. All the spacecraft commands come from there. Aldrin operates the show. He controls the spacecraft.
Tom Gavin is the spacecraft manager at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory and a mine of technical information.
This is where the data will come in. 4 gigabits a day.
Wow.
Cassini's mission is to deliver the Huygens probe to Titan and then orbit Saturn. Its objective, to explain the mysterious rings that circle the planet.
Cassini is a nuclear-powered spacecraft using RTGs, radioisotope heater, because the solar intensity at Saturn is 1/100th of the solar intensity of the Earth, making solar panels impractical.
Okay, this is one of 4 thruster clusters on the Cassini spacecraft. The thruster clusters are hydrazine thrusters, which we use to turn the spacecraft.
This is the fields and particles palette, charged particles, plasma.
This is the remote sensing platform of Cassini. Spectrometers, cameras, imaging systems, the infrared and visible channels, visual imaging mapping spectrometer, the composite infrared spectrograph, the 2 imaging cameras, and the stellar reference unit, which we use to track stars and navigate.
We fly radar to map Titan. We fly magnetometers to look at the magnetic fields of the planet, the interaction with the satellites. From here, we control the spacecraft. So the analogy is to Captain Kirk or Captain Picard on the bridge of the Enterprise. He's surrounded by communications. He deals with his
computer.
He deals with the guidance and control, navigation. And we do the same thing here on the test complex.
Magnify.
Star Trek is a magnification of what it is we want to do. At some point, whether it's the 24th century or the 30th century, we will pick up where Star Trek is.
It appears to be a probe, Captain. From an intelligence unknown to us.
Continue transmitting universal peace and hello in all known languages. Get me Starfleet Command.
Well, it was very interesting. I learned a couple of things about the magnetometers that I didn't know. But most of that stuff I know pretty well, having worked for a couple of years in the space program. The main thing that I try to do in terms of visiting research laboratories is making sure that we try to stay ahead of what's on the cutting edge of scientific and technical research these days.
But it's becoming more difficult for Andre to stay ahead. Science is chasing the Enterprise. And recently, astronomers have discovered a strange new world.
30th of December, 1995, Berkeley, California. Paul Butler spotted the signal of a planet around 70 Virginis. It is the first planet found outside our solar system that could support life.
Star Trek has influenced so many millions of people, and we've been led to believe that Jean-Luc Picard and Captain Kirk dart from planet to planet outside our solar system across the galaxy. And in fact, we astronomers have no such evidence that planets are so common. And what's really exciting is that only in the last few months have we discovered the first planets ever around solar-like stars.
Legends were true, Captain. Fantastically beautiful planet.
Eden, is this what they believe they find?
It was not just a planet, but the first planet that could be defined as M-class, with life-supporting water that Paul Butler and his colleague Jeff Marcy had found.
The big problem with finding planets around other stars is that the stars themselves are so bright that the glare of the star washes out the planet. So we use an indirect technique in which we just watch the star.
Is it within visual range?
Coming within visual range now, Captain.
And we watch to see if the star wobbles around due to the gravitational pull of a planet far away, too faint to see.
Put it on the screen. Extreme magnification.
And it was just this kind of wobble that Paul Butler had detected.
It was really an absolutely astonishing sight. I'd looked at so many stars that didn't have any planets, obviously, that to see one that so incredibly had a planet and was such a huge signal and such an obvious signal that I was just dumbfounded.
Fascinating.
I phoned Jeff at home, and I was still speechless, and I was all I could do to stutter out, Jeff, the office.
You! What planet is this?
Well, this planet that we call Goldilocks has a distance from its star of about a half of an Earth-Sun distance. So it would be a little warmer than the Earth, something like 85 or 90 degrees Celsius, sort of the temperature of a hot cup of tea, but not so warm that water would boil. And for that reason, life itself might spring forth.
I'm almost certain that there is alien life out there somewhere, but my scientific sense of what that might be like is not really relevant to the show. Aliens on Star Trek tend to be much more sort of a metaphor for certain kinds of social conditions or certain kinds of psychological issues that we want to explore in the context of the show.
I am Captain Jean-Luc Picard of the USS Enterprise. Representing a federation of planets in this part of the galaxy, can you identify whoever or whatever you are?
Aliens have their uses for scientists, too.
Calling occupants of interplanetary craft.
August 1977, Robert Dixon of Ohio State University received a signal that might have been extraterrestrial. It certainly bore all the hallmarks of a signal from space. But was it truly extraterrestrial?
Calling occupants of interplanetary craft.
There is a major science initiative to locate extraterrestrials. And at the SETI Institute in Mountain View, California, astronomers Seth Shostak and Frank Drake are getting paid to listen out for aliens.
What we're trying to do here is actually quite simple. We're trying to eavesdrop on any telephone calls, as it were, from extraterrestrials.
Nothing yet, Lieutenant.
Nothing, Captain. Hailing frequencies are open.
This equipment here is actually designed to find the dial tone, as it were, not so much the message.
Hello?
If we were able to pick up a message, of course, that would be very important. It might revolutionize our civilization, but honestly, I'm not so sure we would understand that. It would be pretty much like giving a video signal to Neanderthals, but not giving them a television set.
I've run all frequencies a second time, Captain. There's no...
Now, unfortunately, E.T. never told us where on the dial he might be broadcasting, so we're obliged to search through millions of channels. In fact, this equipment looks at 28 million channels simultaneously and try and find that faint radio signal that would betray the presence of an extraterrestrial society.
And according to Frank Drake, there should be plenty of aliens broadcasting.
We want to find N, the number of detectable civilizations in our galaxy. And that number is going to be related to the rate of star formation. Obviously, the more stars you make, the more possible abodes of life there are. And that rate of production of suitable stars is about 10 per year.
The Drake equation gives the number of stars, relates this to the number of planets, this to the planets on which intelligent life might evolve, and this to the lifetime of any intelligent civilization.
And in that case, N turns out to be, with the numbers I've given you, about 10,000 detectable civilizations in our galaxy.
But for other scientists, Frank Drake's numbers don't add up.
Aliens. Why aren't there any aliens?
There may be 10,000 broadcasting civilizations, but no one has got through to Marvin Minsky, professor at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology.
This is really quite a problem, because the universe is 10 or 15 billion years old, depending on who you believe, and the solar system is supposed to be about 4.3 billion years old, and life started only a few hundred million years ago. So why aren't there other lives that appeared much earlier in the history of the universe, and why aren't they all over the place visiting us every few minutes?
Why haven't they done anything?
Well, it's a bit frightening that we have not made contact with aliens yet.
They're studying us.
No, we've never seen any kind of aliens other than the other crew members that we have on board.
We're totally alone.
But Seth Shostak remains optimistic.
Maybe there's a lot of life in the galaxy, but there's not very much intelligent life. I mean, it could be that Captain Kirk will go out there and find sponges and insects and not too many guys spouting philosophy at him.
Yes, my children. Zeus, Athena, Aphrodite, Artemis, a gallant band of travelers. We knew your Earth well 5,000 of your years ago.
Hello? Hello? Hello?
We are your friends.
I really doubt that they would look like us. And personally, I'm not even sure they're going to be biological. They might not be walking protoplasm the way we are. They might be machine intelligence. Machines would have tremendous advantages when it comes to dispersing through the galaxy, and they may be the dominant life form around.
The producers of Star Trek, though, have no doubt about which sort of aliens are likely to be dominant.
We tend to favor humanoid aliens because it's much easier to do alien makeup on human actors, and we want our characters to be able to interact with these aliens. And in terms of machine intelligence, we have our character Commander Data. He's, in effect, the ultimate user-friendly computer.
Of course, but...
He's somebody that people can feel comfortable around.
You jewel!
And he allows us to explore the very question of what it means to be human.
This question is also being explored in the conception of 20th century machine intelligence.
So this is COG. COG is the first serious attempt at building an intelligent humanoid robot.
At the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, Professor Rodney Brooks is trying to build a robot, like Data, who will be able to relate to the world.
COG has the characteristics of a human. We've got a left arm here, no right arm yet. We have the head with the eyes tracking me around as I move. Maybe I can attract COG's attention over here. And you see, COG has two eyes which can move around much as human eyes can. And what we're trying to do here is build a robot which is able to interact with people in the way that people interact with people.
Would you care for some dinner as well?
As part, I guess, of the the quest that all us science fiction fans grew up with of wanting to build a robot which was just like a human.
I have completed a quest that Data himself has embarked on.
I was able to provide Law with more realistic skin and eye color than my own.
Only in his case, Android has spawned Android.
Congratulations, Data. It's a girl.
But giving birth is just the beginning. The major challenge is Android education.
While motor coordination has improved 12%, reflexes still need to develop. Visual comprehension is especially difficult for Law. Translating her vast data banks into recognizable applications may improve with additional transfers. She is also learning to supplement her innate android behavior with simulated human responses.
Hey, Cynthia?
And it is interesting to note that as I observe Law learning about her world, I share in her experience.
This happens because Lal's brain is identical to Data's. In this respect, Cog represents a fundamentally different approach to android training.
We can't do that with Cog. We can't download our brain contents directly into Cog. Instead, we have to build a brain and then let Cog try and learn about the world in the same way that human infants learn about the world.
I can't believe that Rod thinks Cog's going to be like a child.
It is not a child!
Well, why should biology, rather than technology, determine what's a child?
A new life out of his own being. To me, that suggests a child.
But it obviously can't be like a child, because its body is so different.
You've never been a parent.
But whatever its status, the offspring is learning.
I caught it!
Cog itself is not going to live up to the expectations of Commander Data by any means.
This is what it means to feel.
We're trying almost an impossible goal for now, but by trying to reach that goal, we're finding out the limitations of our current theories.
This is what it means to feel.
And while it may display many characteristics of intelligence, I think it's wishful thinking to think that in our first serious attempt, we're going to get enough of it right to make it really, truly be intelligent. And it's pretty much doomed to failure because it is such an experiment.
Thank you for my life. Flirting. Laughter. Painting family. Female. Humor.
Most days, the messenger from Paramount comes by and brings me my package of scripts. Usually there's a script plus various provisions.
Hello?
I'm Bormanis.
Star Trek is sort of an interstellar soap opera. We have a regular cast of characters, and every week we see them at home, see what's going on in their lives, watch the various challenges that they face. Often they're facing life and death situations.
Great. Right, thanks. See ya.
We do 26 shows a year, and the boxes that you see there are filled with the scripts that I've worked on. I read them, write up my notes, and then fax the notes back over to the studio.
Where Andre's own efforts are judged.
But from a Star Trek consistency point of view, it doesn't make sense.
Yeah, but Mike, I mean, in terms of the basic principles of the system, the way that we've established it operates, I don't see why you can't literally resurrect the dead.
Oh, I'm not arguing from a scientific point of view.
Michael Okuda is the show's scenic arts supervisor, and he is clear about the concessions science must make to Star Trek.
You establish certain capabilities, and you hit this button, and you move someone from one point to another. The way we try to deal with science in Star Trek is first you try to start with what's scientifically plausible, but then you try to filter that through what looks good for television. And besides, if I push some buttons here, it's really cool. Then you filter that through what we can afford to do on a television or a motion picture budget. For example, one of the most brilliant aspects of Star Trek is Gene Roddenberry's invention of the transporter. Landing a spaceship on a planet's surface every week would be just tremendously expensive. So you put our people into a transporter chamber, they disappear, and then they materialize on the planet.
But transportation is the Star Trek science that causes physicists the most problems. Lawrence Krauss has worked out what's involved.
So in the transporter, say you want to dematerialize someone, well, then what you're doing is turning matter into energy.
The molecules in your body are converted into energy, then beamed into this chamber and reconverted back into their original pattern.
Okay, well, that sounds pretty good, except it's an awful lot of energy. In fact, rather environmentally unfriendly. Say you took a 100-kilogram person. Well, if you turn that 100 kilograms into energy, then the energy equivalent would be something like, 1,100 megaton nuclear explosion. Well, that's a pretty big bang. Now, the other option, which may initially seem a little less frightening, is to transport not the atoms, but rather the information or the bits associated with a human being.
Billions of kiloquads of data.
Now, that would involve learning exactly where every single atom is in your body, then recording that information, then transporting the information from here to there, then using some atoms I already have over here to make a replica of you.
Well, if I didn't know so much about these things, maybe they wouldn't scare me so much.
But if I did that, I'd have two copies of you, and I'd have to get rid of the first copy.
You know, maybe ignorance really is bliss.
Reg, transporting really is the safest way to travel.
The advantages of a transporter over any other forms of transport mean that in spite of the slight technical difficulties, there are scientists working on the problem.
If whatever comes our way,
get out of the way.
And John Rarity is a physicist in a hurry.
All the world is a loving place. Fire all of the guns and watch them explode into space.
June 6th, 1996, the Defence Research Agency, England.
Switching on helium neon laser.
With my colleague Paul Tapster, I've been testing a theory that might allow for the teleportation of all the information that describes matter.
Turning on the main laser beam and lights.
It's light that John Rarity and Paul Tapster are trying to teleport in this experiment. They want to transport information about photons, the tiny particles that make up light beams. But they've hit an obstacle, one of physics' most fundamental laws.
In order to teleport something, we need to measure it extremely accurately, right down to the level of the individual molecules, atoms, and photons that make up that object. And this is where we come up against Heisenberg's uncertainty principle.
And that principle states that it's impossible for me to know exactly where every atom is in your body and what it's doing at the same time. And of course, that's precisely what I have to know to transport someone. Now, this means if I could never transport an exact replica of you, but really only an approximation at some level, where things might be different. Like Diana could end up completely naked.
I should have known that even their transporters can't be trusted.
Now, the Star Trek writers got around this by creating Heisenberg compensators.
I once had someone call me on the phone and ask me, well, how does the Heisenberg compensator work? And the only thing I could say was, very well, thank you.
So what we need is a way round the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. And this serious bit of kit allows us to send the information contained in the object without measuring it directly.
Energizing.
And this is how the kit works.
This violet laser goes into this crystal here, where the laser beam is split into pairs of identical particles of light, or photons, which are then fired down to the far end of the apparatus.
One of the identical pair is sent to the location they are transporting to, the other to the place they're transporting from. Here it is compared to the particle they want to transport.
The final stage of the experiment is to communicate that information to the other half of the identical pair, and then to change it by exactly that difference.
Isn't this exciting? We are going to witness a moment in history.
It then becomes identical to the particle that you wanted to teleport.
This should be interesting.
But we never had to measure the original particle, so it hasn't been changed. So there we are, our transporter. Beam me up, Scotty.
So here's the catch, or as physicists like to say, a non-trivial problem. The average person is made up of about 10 to the 28th atoms. And you have to know the position and state of each of those 10 to the 28th atoms if you want to transport someone. And that takes, I've estimated, about 10 to the 28th kilobytes of information.
I can still remember the day in Dr. Olufsen's transporter theory class when he was talking about the body being converted into billions of kiloquads of data.
If you wanted to store that much information, you'd have to stack hard drives from here about a third of the way to the center of the Milky Way galaxy, 10,000 light years away. In fact, it would take longer than the age of the universe to transport that much information. Kind of takes away the excitement, doesn't it?
One atom out of place and poof, you never come back.
Action!
Star Trek is not really a representation of what science will be like in the 24th century.
Could you turn a little more towards us, please?
Nobody really knows what science will be like. So what we're dealing with on the show is not so much the science of Star Trek, but rather Star Trek science.
Andre, help.
Yes, exactly. That's me. I'm the one.
Okay, I never knew that. That's good. Ah. Sometimes I read what it's going to be, and then it says tech. I go, what the hell are they going to come up with for this one?
Yeah, well.
What we try to do on Star Trek is portray a very positive vision of the future. How and whether that vision is achieved comes down to the real scientists and engineers.
Which leads back to the fundamental question, could the Enterprise ever fly? And to the hope contained in 11 atoms of antimatter at CERN.
The problem with these anti-hydrogen atoms is that we don't have them anymore. After creating them, they only lasted for something like 30 nanoseconds because they were traveling along Lear with nearly speed of light. And at the exit of Lear, we had our detectors. Our detectors are made out of normal matter. And if antimatter smashes into matter, it annihilates.
Well, Scotty, now you've done it.
Aye, the haggis is in the fire for sure.
The first big problem with antimatter is one of containment. On small scales, that just means it's hard to hold antimatter in a vessel. But on large scales, if antimatter were released from the warp core of the Enterprise, the whole thing could be destroyed in a massive explosion.
The engines!
Luckily, the problem is under investigation.
Pardon? But we're not doing Star Trek science at all. No, we're doing serious science, of course.
But the scientists at CERN are working on the containment of antimatter.
Okay, Mr. Gabas, okay. Activate the systems.
And their success or failure will have implications for the Enterprise.
Okay, 1 second, please. Let me just check things over.
The problem with experiments is that a million things are going wrong. When you see ready, we're ready. First, we got a traffic.
Okay.
Next, we got to cool it down.
3, 2, 1.
Computer errors.
How was that?
They're not doing their job right. This time, it's not my fault. Things didn't go as well as I'd hoped. Even to hold anti-protons takes such a heroic effort that making anti-hydrogen, for me, seems a long way in the future. Not in my lifetime.
So the problem at the moment is that the Enterprise simply would not fly. I'll say it again. It would never get there.
Bridge, we have a new problem. We're 5 minutes from a warp core breach. There's nothing I can do.
The physics problems include the incredible g-forces needed to accelerate to near light speed, the unimaginable amount of energy that it would take to get there, the need to warp space and time with exotic matter.
All hands, brace for impact!
Not to mention the current world shortage of dilithium crystals.
It's not a future without problems. But it is a future, and it does say that we as the human race will survive into the 24th century and beyond.
I'm gonna miss this ship. She went before her time.
This is the height of the new engine room.
Wow.
What we leave behind is not as important as how we've lived.
Now, this is the warp core for the new ship, then?
This is the warp core.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I always thought I'd get a shot at this chair one day.
We're hoping to make this ship warp 10 capable.
Perhaps you still will. Somehow I doubt that this will be the last ship to carry the name Enterprise.
We're talking about the biggest warp engine we've seen on a starship today.
Wow, that's going to be really amazing.
Go to Farragut. Two to beam up.
But you know, no matter how daunting are the obstacles encountered by the Enterprise, or how far removed it may seem from the physics of today, truth is stranger than fiction, and I think the best is yet to come.